want to spend a few moments in God's Word today from the book of 1 John, the 4th chapter, reading verses 7 to 12. If you want to follow along, that's found on page 1740 in your pew Bibles. 1 John 4, 7 to 12. You should be right back almost into Revelations if you're at the right spot in the Bible. We're only going to read 6 verses, but I want you to listen to how many times the word love appears in these 6 short verses. Here's what God's word says. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. But if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. This is the word of God for the people of God. Heck, I almost just kept right on reading. I enjoy that book. All right, so if you were counting, by the way, 13 times in 6 verses, the word love appears in that text. I think the message of that text has something to do with us needing to love one another. So we want to try to kind of wrap up this sermon series on the on balancing out the journeys. I guess I got to turn it on if I want it to work, don't I? There we go. If you recall, the very first sermon we did in this series, we talked about how if we're going to balance our journeys, there are 2 principles. One, we need to let God set our priorities, not others. And 2, we need to learn to say no so we can say a better yes. And that's a key piece of balance. So we began by talking about the upward journey, our walk with God, and we spent 2 weeks talking about that. How do we balance this walk with God with these other journeys in our life? Then last week we talked about the inward journey, our walk of self-awareness, looking at who we are so that we have a better sense of what God is doing and wants to do in our lives and where he needs to work in our lives, so that our walk with God is better and so that our one another relationship is better. And that's the subject of today's message, is our outward journey, our walk with one another. All right? For me, the outward journey really has a couple of layers, if you will, or levels. And the most general level or layer is the witness level of a journey with one another. And this involves all. When I say all, I'm talking everybody that you interact with, everybody that you rub elbows with, the general masses, if you will. You know, these folks. You may see them on the street. You may see them at Applefest. You may bump into them at the grocery store. You may work with them. You may drive next to them as you're going down the 4-lane of Route 8 South. But in any case, it's just general humanity. And there's a level of outward journey that connects with them, and it's that level at which we witness. So at this level, we're showing Jesus to one another. Our life is a testimony of who Jesus is or is not, based on how we behave. At this level, folks see us and they decide some things about who God is through our speech, through our attitudes, through our behaviors. You see, people make judgments and conclusions about us by how we act. Therefore, they will make judgments and conclusions about Jesus, the Jesus we follow, by how we act. You say, well, these people don't know I'm a Christian. Oh, don't be so sure. They do know you're a Christian. They at least know you go to church. And it's a great opportunity for us to begin to lay down an opportunity to have conversations with people about Christ just by how we act, by what we say. The struggle at this point in the journey is, there's a hard question. What message are others seeing or hearing from your life? What message are they seeing or hearing from your life? Are they hearing a message of love or a message of condemnation, a message of gratitude or a message of selfishness? What are they hearing from your life? Reminds me of a story that Charles Swindoll tells of when he pastored a church in Dallas, Texas, and they were in crazy traffic one morning, and he's driving along, and the guy behind him is getting increasingly agitated by his driving, and so he finally finds an opportunity. He goes over to the slow lane, and the guy behind him blows past him and gives him the universal sign of how intelligent he is with one finger, and at that point, as the guy looks to the right, he realizes he has just flipped off his pastor. Can you imagine the following Sunday morning? Wow. What are others seeing or hearing from your life? What are they learning about God when they see you interact with the wait staff at a restaurant or with customer service at Walmart or with the person taking your order at McDonald's or as you drive down the highway? Our life has an outward journey at a witness level. This is what Romans says. Romans 13, 8 to 10 says, "Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and whatever other commandments there may be are summed up in this one command, love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law." No harm. John Wesley developed what we affectionately refer to now as three simple rules. He said, there are three things that ought to guide our lives. He said, do no harm, do good, and stay in love with God. Now, he said them with a little more flair than that, but that's really what it boils down to. So in our witness level outward journey, are people experiencing no harm? Are they experiencing good? Or is something else going on? That's the most basic level of an outward journey. That's our outward journey to all. But let's be honest, where we prefer to move is in a circle of fellowship level, where we interact with some. And by some, I mean a fellowship level where you're with like-minded people. You know, a smaller crowd, if you will. And maybe this group that you're fellowship level outward journeying with is a group of like-minded people. Maybe you guys come together over sports or over a particular hobby. Maybe it's your Sunday school class, or even here at worship. At the fellowship level, there we go. At the fellowship level, we walk with one another. Our time together becomes an opportunity for support, encouragement, and growth. A fellowship level is an open level group. You know what I mean by that? People can come, people can go. You know, in the sanctuary, you're not always sitting with the same people, amen? But you made a conscious choice to come to the sanctuary this morning for worship. You could have stayed home and tuned this in Thursday night on cable and been good, or you could have watched it on the app and got the worship service, but you chose to come to the sanctuary because at a fellowship level, there is an added benefit, right? As you rub elbows, as you shake hands, as you greet one another, as you see each other, as you check in with one another, some things happen. I love it when a church is chatty before worship, because what it means is people are fellowshipping. There's some connection. I served a church one time that had this big bronze plaque above the door going into the sanctuary. It says, "Enter in silence." Silence. So we're sitting at a council meeting one time, and a lady, she said, "We have a problem." I said, "What's the problem?" She said, "There is far too much talking going on in the sanctuary before worship." I said, "Why is that a problem?" She said, because there's a sign over the door that says enter in silence. I said, that's not a problem. Just take down the sign. Not what she wanted to hear. You see, when we fellowship together, you may get an extra blessing, and it may not even be from someone you know real well. They come up and give you a hug or say something nice to you or connect with you, and you walk out of here feeling like, wow, that was encouraging. That's fellowship level. The tough part is the question. Do others feel better or worse after spending time in my presence? Do others come away from that time feeling blessed, like I have given them a bit of light and life, or like I am sharing with them words of death and robbing them of light and life? I have a relative that a few years back, every time you would call him, he would answer the phone this way: hey, loser, what are you doing? We'd chuckle and we'd talk. I think his wife got to him, because not long after that, I start calling him and I get the same response: hey, winner, what are you doing? I like the second much better. Sometimes it's what we say. We think we're saying things in jest, and that's not how people are hearing them. They're hearing them as put-downs, criticisms, judgments. Can we build people up at the fellowship level? Can we allow them a moment in the spotlight? Or does everything we do with everyone have to revolve around us? I refer to those as people whose world is 18 inches across. It's about this big. Doesn't matter what's happening, it always comes back to a story about them and how they have it harder than you, they're better than you, they have no more than you. And you know, you see those people coming and you say that really quick flash prayer: oh Lord, I pray they do not notice me. Amen? You know those people. I know those people. All right. The third level of outward journey, the deepest level, is community level. And in a community level, we go from everybody to some to a few. Some people at the community level call this a connection group or a life group, a covenant group. These groups, community level groups, are closed groups. Closed because we make a conscious decision that this is going to be the circle of our community, and we're going to intentionally build depth here. So we can't have people floating in and out, because that disrupts community. It doesn't mean we're being cliquey or snobbish or arrogant. It means we've drawn a circle and we want to go deep here so that we can grow more like Christ, so that we can experience healing at a deeper level, so that we can share at a deeper level. You see, at this level, we belong to one another. Our connection is with a select few, and that promotes deep growth, wholeness. At the community level, you hear things in the group like, I've never shared this with anybody. You hear things like, if this got out, it would be devastating. You hear things like, I cannot believe I'm telling you this. And you have deep, empathic listening and caring. When I talk about my covenant group, I'm talking about community level outward journey. There are five of us. You can do this in a group of 12, but it's tough. The first time I experienced this level of outward journey in the church was probably in 1994 at Lander United Methodist Church. I was leading Disciple Becoming Disciples through Bible Study. It's a 34-week Bible study program. Participants agree to read 30 to 45 minutes a day, 6 days a week, and then they sit in group for 2.5 hours. People have accused me of running a college course, and it really is that level. But about week six, somebody had the courage to just share their heart, to dump it out on the table, junk and all, and that group gelled, and it became community. So much so that in that church, oftentimes when one of these disciple Bible studies would end, people would come to me in the months following and saying, listen, this is kind of weird, but I'm experiencing depression. Yep. Because you see, they'd had community every week for 9 months, and then it stopped. They said, we need another study. I said, no, you need to form a group and go do ministry now. Form a group so you have community, but reach out and do ministry. Let me tell you where my heart is. I believe that the church of Jesus Christ today is suffering from a lack of community level interaction. If we had more community, we'd have less bickering, fighting, and division in the body. And it doesn't have to be only people from Christ United Methodist Church that you're in community with. But you have to be very intentional about who you're in community with. And you need to understand that in that level of community, there is absolute confidentiality. And there's a lot of risk involved. But when you get there, those of you who have been there know, it's a beautiful thing. It's an amazing experience. Because we have an opportunity to journey with people, to carry their burdens, to celebrate with them, to cry with them. In July, our covenant brother, Pat Lennox's father, passed away in Meadville. Now, the other four of us, some of us had met Pat's dad. But you know, there was no question of what the covenant group would do. We had to go be with our brother. He had experienced a loss. Whether we knew his dad or not was immaterial. We had to be there. You know how that goes. When you're in community, anytime there is such a situation, you just go. Because we share life at that depth. I love this quote by Jean Vanier, or as it looks like on a screen, Jean Vanier. But Jean Vanier, in his book Community and Growth, says this: there's a difference between community and a group of friends. That is, in community, we verbalize our mutual belonging and bonding. We recognize also that this bonding comes from God. I'm sure someplace out there are some community level fellowship or some community level outward journey groups that are not Christ-based, but I've not seen one. Because quite honestly, if it's community level, it is so risky that you need God there to grease the wheels. Otherwise, there's just too much competition in the world. You see, when Christ shows up, then all of the sudden, I don't have to be the center of attention. It's not about me. And for the next hour or two, we have all the time in the world to care for you. That level of outward journeying is a real blessing. But that level also comes with a hard question. Are you willing to know and be known by others? Are you willing to carry somebody else's baggage, somebody else's junk, and hold it in strict confidence? Are you willing to know people at that level? Are you willing to allow others into the recesses of your life to know you at that level? Knowing that they may find some things there that they're going to need to challenge you on. But mostly they're going to be willing to just cry with you over the brokenness of your life. Are you willing? Well, we began our journey talking about our walk with God, our upward journey. Our inward journey, our walk of self-awareness, and today, our walk with others, our outward journey. But we must always be asking ourselves, am I allowing God to set my priorities in whatever journey we're talking about? Is God setting the priority as I interact with other people? Is God allowed to set the priority as I decide what part of my inner life I need to work on next? Is God setting the priority in terms of how I worship, when I worship, when I spend time with Him? And we often find ourselves needing to say no to a lot of other things so we can say a better yes. You will not have a community group without some significant no's being said. And it may be no to an individual joining that group, because you know that that would change the dynamic. One question, though, that may still be lingering in the back of your mind, because we've been talking about God's grace, God's love, how it's His grace that takes us down the road of sanctification and makes us whole. It's His grace that changes us, and there's nothing beyond the care of His grace. And it may prompt in you a question: does my behavior really matter? After all, the pastor stood in the pulpit a couple weeks ago and said, there is nothing you can do to make God love you any more, and there's nothing you can do to make God love you any less. So what's the deal on behavior? Does it really matter? Well, though this series is over, I want to take one more week and I want to talk about behavior. Does it really matter? How much does it matter? Where and when does it matter? Let's be honest, if you're going to form community, you better know something about behavior. There are some things in community that are off limits. There are some things in fellowship that are off limits. And if you don't recognize that in your witness there's some stuff that's off limits, then your witness probably is suffering. So next week, we're going to talk about behavior. All right? Let's pray. Father God, we connect with people every day. Some of them, Father, we just pass on the street and say hi. They're looking at us at a witness level. May we fairly represent you. Other times, Father, we are together with people that we know a bit better. Folks that we've rubbed elbows with a time or two. We know their name and what they do. We don't know all about their life, but we know some things. May those opportunities be a blessing to them as we strive to encourage and support and build up. And Father, if we are fortunate enough to have a community level group, I just pray, Lord, you continue to bless it with grace. And if we long for that, even if we don't, Father, we pray you'd give us a longing for that and create for us, Lord, a place, a niche, an environment where we can share our heart at such a level that we are known as we know others. May those groups be a healing balm upon our lives. We ask this in the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.